Welcome back to the class. We are beginning the discussion of yet another very, very important and theoretically very rigorous argument about reflexive modernity propounded by a host of scholars, but most prominent among them is Ulrich Beck. And Ulrich Beck is a very prominent scholar of sociology, and especially scholar of globalization. And we will have a detailed discussion on Beck's arguments about a wide variety of issues in the coming weeks. We will have a discussion on his Beck's arguments about the changing nature of nation state. We will have his very famous arguments about the risk society. We will have a look at his arguments about methodological cosmopolitanism. And I remember we already discussed his argument about cosmopolitanism, rooted cosmopolitanism, in one of the introductory, one of the lectures in the chapter on cultural globalization. So Ulrich Beck, the German sociologist, is a very, very important figure in the discussion on globalization. And why that we are discussing him here is that, as I mentioned in several of the previous classes, that he is a very important advocate of the group of scholars who argue against the postmodernist argument, who argues very vehemently, very forcibly, that what we are seeing around us is an extension, or it's a radicalized form of modernity. And this particular essay, so here I'm going to discuss it elaborately. I think we might take three sessions to discuss a single essay. It's a lengthy essay, around 30 pages. So we will go a bit slow, but we will go in detail analyzing this particular essay. So I'm not using PowerPoint, rather I'm going to discuss his original essay, which is a very important essay. Okay, it's a very important essay. It's 33 pages, maybe including references, but and it's a very dense essay, not very easy to follow, especially towards the second part of the essay. So we will go slow, we will analyze, we will examine this essay in detail. And it's written not only by Ulrich Beck, but Wolfgang Borns and Christoph Lau, and it's titled The Theory of Reflexive Modernity. Okay, the theory of reflexive modernity, problematic hypothesis and research program. It's a very broad ranging, very it's a very ambitious essay in that sense. It's too ambitious in terms of its theoretical range, what it intends, and other things. So let's get started. Now, at the very beginning, he makes it clear that what does he mean by the term reflexivity. And by the way, this essay was published in 2003, and it's published in one of the most prestigious journals, Theory, Culture and Society. Theory, Culture and Society is one of the most prestigious journals on social theory. So in the very beginning, he makes it very clear, the modernization of modern society, what does he mean by reflexivity. And reflexivity we came across in Giddens as well. So in Giddens, what we understood by reflexivity was that there is a kind of a spiraling relationship between the knowledge about society, especially produced by disciplines like sociology, and the society. So this the sociological knowledge that we create about society gets it gets translated into society, thereby making changes there, and which is further been studied by sociologists or other social sciences. So there is a dialectical relationship between the discipline and the society, so that they are mutually shaping each other. So our understanding about society is also shaping the practices of society itself. But here Beck is using this term in a slightly different way, okay, something very different than what kind of Giddens thinks about it. So the reflexivity in reflexive modernization is often misunderstood. It is not simply a redundant way of emphasizing the self-referential quality that is a constitutive part of modernity. So earlier, you know, the argument of modernity is that modernity enables you, or modernity inspires you, to look at your own actions in a critical manner. So that used to be the idea of reflexivity earlier, because you are kind of disenchanted. You are no longer enchanted by the supernatural or religious belief. So you constantly evaluate your own actions on the basis of rationality. But here, that is not the idea of reflexivity at all that Beck wants to discuss. Instead, what reflexive modernization refers to is a distinct second phase, the modernization of modern society. And this is an extremely important point that you need to keep in mind. He is talking about the modernization of modern society, or that is why where this distinction of first modernity and second modernity also comes. It refers to a distinct second phase, the modernization of modern society. When modernization reaches a certain stage, it radicalizes itself. So instead of calling it as a postmodern society, which indicates that the era of modernity is over, these scholars are repeatedly asserting that what we are seeing today is a radicalized form of modernity. It begins to transform for a second time not only the key institutions but also the very principles of society. But this time, the principle and institutions being transformed are those of modern society. Okay, so if modern society, if modernity really represented a break from the traditional society by transforming its core institutions, like say political and cultural and economic institutions, now this second modernity or reflexive modernity is also representing such kind of a break, because it is transforming the conditions of modernity. Okay, so the dominant container of modern society, which often tacitly and the more tenaciously for that identify society with the nation state, presumes a larger number of interlocking social institutions. Okay, among them are a reliable wealth. So these are the kind of features or the quintessential features of a modern society: a nation state, a reliable welfare state, mass practices anchored in class culture, and a stable nuclear family consisting of a single breadwinner, his housewife and their children. So this has been the character of modernity, how the most dominant picture of modernity was understood. Now these institutions are supported by and in turn support a web of economic security woven out of industrial regulation. Okay, full employment and lifelong careers, and you know that's how we experienced modernity. Now he argues that reflexive modernization throws all of these basic social principles into flux. Okay, in first modern or simple modern societies, social change is conceived as occurring within a stable system of coordinates. But the challenge of theorizing reflexive modernization is that the system of coordinates is changing. Okay, if the fundamental distinction that criteria that we have always identified with modern society no longer apply, where can one begin? What can modern society mean if not nation state? So how can one make reasonable decisions about the future under conditions of such uncertainty? And how can one reflexive social institutions develop and grow into a world that is in some respects literally boundless? Framed thus, the theory of reflexive modernization has to be worked out theoretically and tested empirically. So as I mentioned, it's a theoretical project, which is very ambitious, which comes with kind of very, very interesting theoretical implications. Now, at stake in this and in defining a thematic is a decidedly non-linear notion of change and modernity. The hypothesis of a reflexive modernization of modern societies examines a fundamental societal transformation within modernity. Modernity has not vanished, but it's becoming increasingly problematic. Okay, that's a fundamental point that we have mentioned several times. While crisis transformations and radical social change have always been part of modernity, the transition to a reflexive second modernity not only changes social structure but revolutionizes the very coordinates, categories and conceptions of change itself. So in the latter part of this essay, we will see how he even theorizes this kind of a changes, because you require a reconceptualization of change itself to make sense of that. This meta change of modern society results from a critical mass of unintended side effects. And this is a very favorite term for all these scholars who want to, you know, emphasize this whole point about unintended side effects of modernity. Okay, we wanted modernity to move in a particular direction with the help of rationality, science and technology, but modernity also produced a lot of side effects which we never wanted, okay, which we never intended. And these side effects are now taking a central stage, assuming a central role, and started, you know, producing more and more unintended consequences, and things have simply gone out of hand. That's what Giddens says when he talks about the runaway world. This unintended side effects. By unintended side effects, or more precisely, effects that were originally intended to be more narrow in their scope than they turned out to be, we mean the host of consequences resulting from the boundary shattering force of market expansion, legal universalism, and technical revolution. In short, the processes that Marx once celebrated as that by which everything solid melts into air. So, Marx used this particular phrase to describe the era of you know, modernity and the rise of capitalism. So here, this rise of modernity is what is something for us to look at. In the transformation from first modernity that was largely synonymous with the nation state to second modernity, the shape of which is still being negotiated, modernization ends up stripping away the nation and welfare state, which at one time supported but later restrained it. In doing so, modernization is calling into question its own basic premises. So, this argument is revolving around the idea that some of the very basic coordinates, okay, basic pillars of modernity, including a nation state, a welfare nation state, and capitalism, and centrality of science and rationality, and industrial production, okay, these are undergoing significant transformation. But unlike postmodernists, these scholars are not ready to overthrow these courses, but rather they call into attention to understand and to problematize these emerging features, emerging characterizations. Now, this sentence, this paragraph is something very important, because in a very simple language, he makes a distinction between what is reflexive modernity and what is postmodernity. What is the difference between reflexive modernity and postmodernity? Despite the fact that there are many meanings to the word postmodernity, and many of them overlap with the concept of reflexive modernity, there is still a clear difference between the two. The theory of remodernization or reflexive modernization maintains that there are new rules of the game for our political and social systems, and the task of social science is to grasp them, describe them, understand them, and explain them. So, whereas for many theorists of postmodernism, the issue is one of the destructuration of society and deconceptualization of social sciences, for remodernization, it is a matter of restructuration and reconceptualization. The goal is to decipher the new rules of the social game even as they are coming into existence. So, unlike postmodernists, who are extremely critical of some of the conceptual categories of social sciences and the ability of social sciences to theorize and then conceptualize them, okay, and to have an explanatory potential to make sense of this whole world, the reflexive modernists still believe in that potential, still believe in that possibility. And they believe that social scientists need to be more rigorous. Okay, social sciences need to develop more rigorous frameworks and categories and theoretical perspectives to make sense of this unfolding society, rather than saying that they can't be made sense of. But the old certainties, distinctions, and dichotomies are fading away. But through the close investigation of these processes, we can discover what is taking their place. This approach couldn't be more foreign to the farewell to science view found in some quarters of postmodernism. And we know that at least some sections of postmodernism almost says that science is over, or they want to reduce science to the status of, say, for religion or magic or any other kind of existing world system that offers you certain explanation. Okay, so there is a very serious attempt, concerted attempt, to discredit science, of course, science-centric argument is very problematic. But at the same time, the attempt to completely discredit science, completely, you know, to consider science and scientific research and scientific outlook as just one among the various available, frameworks to lead your life is extremely problematic. It's extremely problematic. Rather, it is a call for strengthening social sciences. Okay. This approach couldn't be more foreign to the farewell to science view found in some quarters of postmodernism. Rather, it's a call for strengthening of social sciences. Social science can no longer aspire to take a God's eye point of view and control that goes with it, but it can find another way to know that. Yeah. The following section will examine different key aspects of modernization, and we will do it one by one. And this is the kind of a sequence in which he analyzes this particular chapter. The first is the distinction between first and second modern society. Second one is this discontinuity at the heart of the modern, the hypothesis of an historical break, forms of meta change and concrete examples, and empirical and analytical criteria for testing theory of reflexive modernization. So I intend to take maybe two more sessions to complete this essay, because I want to go slow. I want to explain as much as possible, because it's a very important essay. So let us begin with this first one, the distinction between first and second modern society. So what is the central meaning of the word reflexive in reflexive modernization? Reflexive does not mean people today lead a more conscious life. On the contrary, reflexive signal signifies not an increase of mastery and consciousness, but a heightened awareness that mastery is impossible. Okay, look at how jarring or how forceful that argument is. Okay, because we all were under the impression that we can understand society better, you can control society better. But now the reality is that now we realize that such a mastery is impossible to attain. Okay, reflexive signifies that not an increase in the mastery and consciousness. Okay, mastery, your ability to control things around you. This control things around you, maybe it could be the nature, it could be society, it could be social institutions, political institutions, it could be the people around you. Okay, the mastery over it and the consciousness to understand how it works, but a heightened awareness that mastery is impossible. Okay, simple modernization becomes reflexive modernization to extent that it disenchants and then dissolves its own taken for granted premises. Eventually, this leads to the undermining of every aspect of nation state. The welfare state, the power of legal system, the national economy, the corporate systems that connected one with another, and the parliamentary democracy that governed it as a whole. So this particular understanding is what he is going to elaborate. And he begins with the premises of a first modern society. So what were the basic premises of a first modern society? And we know that we will realize it only when we compare these systems with a pre-modern an agricultural feudal society that existed in the medieval period. Now, first modern societies are nation-state societies, okay, defined by territorial boundaries. Modern societies' social relations are conceived as contained in a national territory, and most institutions boast an integrated relations to the nation-state. And this is something that we have discussed several times when we talked about methodological nationalism. Modern societies are seen as societies that are, you know, that are contained within the boundaries of a nation state. When we talk about Pakistani society, when we talk about India society, when we talk about a Sri Lankan society, we assume naturally the idea that comes to our mind is a group of people who are living within the geographical boundary. Okay, and this geographical boundary is defined by the boundary set by the nation state. And we could not really think of a society that makes this geographical boundaries irrelevant. Okay. Second one is that modern societies distinguished themselves by a programmatic individualization. Okay. So, first modern societies distinguish themselves by a programmatic individualization. But this is crucially bounded on several sites by patterns of collective life that are heavily reminiscent of pre-modern structures that determined one's status by birth. So even when modernity celebrated the rise of the individual, we know that this individual in that sense was never born, at least maybe in very few places. But these individuals also had located themselves in the larger societal markers of their religion, their ethnicity, their language, their nation, their affinity and other things. Individuals in this society are theoretically free and equal, and their associations are voluntary. But their freedom and equality are molded by social institutions. For example, the sexual division of labor that are many respect coercive. Okay, so who you are an individual, but your individuality is heavily constrained by the fact that you are a woman or you are a man, and then it proceeds the kind of roles and duties, status, jobs that are good for you, the kind of things that you can that you can aspire to, a lot of stuff. And third one, the first modern societies are work societies, or more precisely gainful employment societies. In their fully developed form, they are what was once called in Europe full employment societies, that is, societies in which unemployment is so low that it can justifiably be considered as frictional. Okay, so we think that gainful employment, that people, especially men are seen as the breadwinners, especially in the early modern period. And a gainful employment, especially a lifelong employment, secure full-time employment with a retirement plan. So that was seen yet another taken for granted assumption. And the fourth point, the first modern society is a peculiar concept of nature founded on its exploitation. Nature is simultaneously central to society and marginalized. It appears as the outside of society. Nature is conceived of as a natural, neutral resource which can and must be made available without limitation. And we know that, isn't it? Nature was seen as an endless resource. So natural resources. We learned, or capitalism taught us to look at the forest, or look at the soil, or look at the sea as resources that needs to be exploited, resources that needs to be used. And many times we thought that there won't be any short supply of that. Okay, we were under the illusion that most of these resources would be unlimited, they would be endless. But we were all for a rude shock when maybe 1960s and 70s, when we began to become more conscious about the ecological consequences of that, and that's why a huge rethinking began to take shape among our people about the whole question of ecological balance, about environmental sustainability and a host of other things. And the fifth point, first modern societies unfolded themselves on the basis of a scientifically defined concept of rationality that emphasizes instrumental control. Rational progress is conceived as a process of demystifying that can continue without limits. This implies a belief that a scientization can eventually perfect control of nature. Okay, we know that science and rationality was seen as the epitome of human achievement, and science has the ability to control nature. And we built huge dams, we created human wonders by very actively interfering in the natural events. And it all gave us the confidence that you will be able to control the natural forces, and science and technology, the possibilities of science and technology are infinite, and you can use these science and technology to control and to tame the nature. Okay, I remember an advertisement of I think Larsen and Toubro company, L&T, an old advertisement, which say that the technology can able to move the mountains and stop the rivers. Okay, so that used to be the kind of optimism. With the technology, they can move the mountains and then stop the rivers. Obviously, it's true that we have constructed huge dams, and we have earth movers, and we can move the mountains. But the point is that now we realize that we can do that, but it's better not done, isn't it? We know that it's not always a good thing to stop a river and to construct a dam or to simply remove a huge hill or a mountain, because the ecological consequences could be much, much disastrous. Okay, so this this endless optimism about the progress of science and technology was something very defining character of first modernity. And the first modern societies understand and manage the development according to the principle of functional differentiation, a division of society into social subsystems and various patterns of social actions make development appear synonymous with the growth of complexity. So it all based on this idea of functional differentiation. As and when those who have studied Durkheim would understand it better, he talks about the emergence of society and then increasing division of labor and increasing functional differentiation. As and when a society increases more, division of labor increases, and each specialized section works on specific functions. And because of this extreme form of division of labor, there is also a kind of a complementarity. There is also a kind of a mutual interdependence, and that was again the basis of that. Now this summary of the premises of first modern society is neither systematic nor complete. Yeah, but then he also talks about certain kind of processes of modernization that made them first possible and then necessary, and finally rendered them obsolete. Let us deal with the initial part of the process first. What kind of processes that were were underlying in this process of first modernity? These premises are gradually integrated as tacit assumptions underlying first modern society through a process of naturalization and anthropologization. Such a naturalization was prerequisite for the developing of the following social structures. There are quite a few. Let's examine one by one. One is the nation state, as we mentioned, first seen as an achievement and later as a limitation, upon whose territorial framework every social institution of the first modern society is based. This in turn entailed the territorial organization of production, corporation and regulation as the stage upon which opposition of capital and labor was first witnessed before their reappearing as reconcilable. Okay, so the opposition between the capital and the worker was seen as taking place within the boundaries of nation. Then the sexual division of labor, often referred to as a fact of nature. Isn't it? We were told that men and women are different, they are physically different, this sexual division of labor is something quite natural. And nuclear family as a condition, reproduction and guarantee of the predominantly male labor power commodity. Okay, nuclear family, where only the man becomes the breadwinner, and wife's duty is only to only to take care of the family and kind of procreation. And the relatively close off social milieu and work and life worlds of the proletarian and the bourgeoisie, upon which basic class structures could develop into intermediary social identities. The differentiation and separation of social subsystems, that is economy, politics, technological management, culture and science, which were eventually experienced as separate, distinct and hierarchical. They were never seen as integrated seemingly, but they were seen as separate entities. The restructuring of social knowledge, altering its hierarchy so that experiential and occupational knowledge was devalued and theoretical and supervisory knowledge was increased in status. We know that even especially in India, the kind of disconnect between theory and practice. We know with the rise of modern engineering disciplines, the traditional craft and artisans have lost their significance. Okay, for thousands of years we have had made tremendous achievements in metallurgy, in craft, in a series of artisanship jobs, and that included both the theory as well as that of the practice. They were the practitioners. These caste groups or these artisanal groups were practitioners. But with the rise of modern industry or modern capitalism and the idea of modern engineering, there is a major break between theory. You study theoretically and with least regard to the historicity of this particular transmission of these techniques and knowledge, and with scant regard to these practitioners. So that is a very, very important area of interest for many people who work in the history of science and technology. Now, the creation of a hierarchy between experts and laymen, which was grounded on the monopoly of knowledge by professionals, the rise of the professional class as a group. These developments are naturalized on the self-description of modern society into two senses. On the one hand, it is argued that they rest on natural distinction, and the other, and it's also from a naturalization, these social distinctions appear as they are largely unalterable. Okay, so these things were seen as natural. Natural means it's as if they were part of a nature. Okay, and since they are natural, okay, they can't be changed. You remember the idea about homosexuality, the criticism against homosexuality, or the Indian penal code which criminalized homosexuality, because homosexual relations are seen as against the nature, because heterosexuality was seen as the norm, it was seen as natural, anything else was seen as unnatural. Even now we use the term unnatural. Okay, but these problems are considered contingent and do not seriously undermine the first modern faith. That continuing, yeah. So now he comes to the challenges and dynamics of second modernity. Challenges and dynamics of second modernity. Okay. So if we have discussed all these points which were the central concerns of first modernity, let us have a look at the what are the these foundational arguments of second challenges and dynamics of second modernity. Now, globalization undermines the economic foundations of the first modern society, and with the idea of a society as a nation state. Okay, this is a contentious issue, because we know that there are quite a lot of scholars who argue that this nation state is regaining its lost significance. Okay, but there is a major refashioning, okay, major restructuring of the roles of nation state is definitely taking place. This is because structural changes that are often referred to in shorthand as vanishing borders have effects far beyond their immediate impact on the economy. So this whole idea of a vanishing border, borders becoming immaterial, borders becoming porous, borders becoming flexible, had a tremendous impact on not only on the economy but on the cultural as well as the social aspects. And the best example is that of the European Union, okay, where several countries, around 24-25 countries, come together and they decide to have a common currency, they decide to have a common visa rule, free movement of people, art, products, everything. So that was something quite unprecedented, and we must know that these countries were kind of fighting with each other, okay, a few decades back. And from 1960s onwards, the welfare state and has provided the basic for an intensification of individualization. Okay, the result has been the erosion of several ascriptive patterns of collective life, each of which has gradually lost its legitimacy. So the kind of individualization that was already in place with the first modernity reaches a more radicalized form with that of second modernity. The universalization of freedom and equality represents a further development of key modern social principles, but this is creating hitherto unknown social norms, while undermining several familiar ones that once were at the institutional heart of first modernity. Okay, we know that the extreme form of individualization, extreme form of your reflexivity about your sexual orientation. Okay, now we know that heterosexuality is one among the sexual orientations. It could be bisexual, a person could be bisexual, person could be, the divisions are endless in that sense. So this is something quite new. Okay, it doesn't mean that people did not have these ideas or orientations earlier, but to have a discourse on this and to have an institutionalized acceptance and categories and divisions is something very, very new. And an important aspect of this expansion of individualization has been the transformation of gender roles. Okay, research shows that categories like men and women are not copies of a more originary heterosexuality, but they showed how the so-called originals, men and women, within the heterosexual frame are constructed, performatively established. Okay, he is specifically talking about Judith Butler and her argument about performativity of gender. So Butler does not agree with the argument that the sex is biological and gender is social. Okay, that's the conventional social social theory that tells you that while the sex is biological, whether a child is born as male or female, it's biological, it's based on chromosome, based on the sexual organ. Where the gender is social, okay, whether you are grown up as male or female. But she goes much beyond than that. And then she argues that the gender is a result of performativity. Okay, from the very beginning, a child is learned to perform repetitively. Okay, repetitively is forced to perform certain kind of role. So gender is seen as a product of performativity. Okay, I'm not going into the detail, but it's a very influential theory by she draws on Foucault and a host of other scholars. Thus changing the internal dynamics of families, producing the normal chaos of love, and dissolving the sexual division of labor affects the labor market from two directions. Okay, so this gender role, so what it means to be a boy or what it means to be a girl, and how are they supposed to live, how are they supposed to look like, what kind of dress are they supposed to wear, what kind of orientations, what kind of jobs, what kind of work that they can do, all these are very open questions now. Okay, we are now moving away from very specific kind of stipulations that used to be the order of the day. The flexible employment, now this has a very specific impact on the on employment practices. The flexible employment practices that appeared in the wake of the third industrial revolution express in their own chronic form a breakdown in the full employment society, and perhaps even in the central significance of gainful employment. Okay, so this whole idea about a full employment, that you will have a lifelong job, you will have a permanent job, and then throughout your productive life you will be engaged in a particular job, and you will retire, you will work only one job, these ideas are now fast changing. Okay, we are seeing an economy where people are hired, people work as freelancers, people are hired and fired with much of an ease. So this whole idea of one person sticking to one job throughout his career is very seriously being challenged. Last, we must add the political dynamics that is being set in motion by the perception of a global ecological crisis, which includes acknowledgement of limited resources. Okay, I don't need to explain that. We are talking about a host of other stuff. We are talking about renewable energy and other things, but they're all coming from this realization that the conventional energy sources are fast drying up. Now, how these developments are expressed and the potential they have for altering the course of modernization can only be made clear through empirical research. But the outline sketched above, a revolution of side effects, shows why terms like ambivalence, ambiguity, perplexity, and contradiction occur so often in the literature. Where indeed does one begin to define the situation? Okay, who could be the possible subject of a feasible reform? The institutionalized answers for the first modern society to self-produced problems, for example, more and better technology, more economic growth, more scientific research, and more specialization, are less persuasive than they once were, although it is not at all clear what should take their place. Okay, so our emphasis, our obsession with technology, our obsession with economic growth, our obsession with science, it's less convincing. You know that now people are talking about degrowth. Okay, people are talking about degrowth. People say that you can't really grow like this. The world cannot grow at this pace because there has to be an end. Capitalism cannot grow like this. But what is the alternative? Okay, if the economy does not grow, can we afford to have a recession? What are the consequences of a recession? Do we have an alternative economic model which can be applied? Of course, there are different experiments taking place, but can we have something which can be replicated, which can be employed at a global level? So all these are important questions. So this particular distinction between first and second modern society also has the virtue of setting clear boundaries for theoretical inquiry. Since the theory posits first modern society as a prerequisite for the second modern society, there are groups of countries it doesn't apply. For example, parts of Africa and Asia. So he's very clear that what he's presenting is a Eurocentric, because Europe is a place where the first modernity emerged, and Europe is a place where this is experiencing this wave of second modernity. So how it articulates in other places, or do we have alternative modes of the second modernity or reflexive modernity, these are yet to be analyzed and then argued, because there is quite a lot of literature on alternative modernities or multiple modernities. So this is also something interesting to look into that. So yeah, so we will, I think we will stop here and continue with the second point in the next class. As I told, I'll take maybe two more sessions to complete this essay. Okay, so thank you.